This is your evening news update for Tuesday, December 7th. Government has refuted claims that it has resorted to printing money in order to finance its operations. Speaking in Parliament today as he tabled the Fair Credit Reporting Bill, Minister in the Ministry of Finance, Ryan Strawn, was at pains to explain that government has been using money received from the International Monetary Fund.
Based on all of the reports that we have received from the International Monetary Fund, all of the reports that we've received from the credit rating agencies, that we will put this into the market as a way for us to be able to move back into a process whereby the government can resume, in a sense, its financing mechanism. And therefore, it is not by any stretch of the imagination, sir, by any stretch of the imagination, any printing of money in the way that the last government was that they were doing. It belongs to the government of Barbados as a member of the International Monetary Fund. Just like if you are a member of the credit union declares a surplus, you get a little piece. So Barbados get peace, sir, Antigua get peace, Jamaica get peace, Trinidad get peace, everybody get peace, sir. And because of the way for us to get the access the money, the way that the law was structured, this is the mechanism through which we've determined that we will do it to ensure then that we are in a position to continue to respond to the public policy.
However, his explanation did not sit well with opposition leader Joseph Averley, who charged that government was not managing its fiscal affairs properly.
And when you do repay, and especially if you're not generating enough, and when you're faced with the strain and stress of repaying, what are the implications for the ability of the state to provide public services and social service benefits to which the state is committed by long-established policy and under law? These questions are serious questions. When faced, therefore, with the challenges that arise out of that kind of a scenario, high and mounting debt, low or non-existent growth, you have to repay because you can't default. You want to be in a position to provide social services and provide for public service and other social security benefits that we are committed to under law and regulation and policy. Then you have to resort to liens on the NIS, as we have done in the past. You have to resort to liens on the Central Bank of Barbados, as we're doing now or proposing to do. And you can describe it in whatever terms you want, but at the end of the day, you're making recourse to Central Bank financing in a challenging situation.
Changes are coming to make it easier to conduct business in the financial sector in Barbados. Minister in the Ministry of Finance, Ryan Strawn, says a national payment system will be introduced to ensure transactions from different institutions can be done instantaneously.
We're transforming this whole thing, Mr. Speaker, because whenever you make a payment, sir, the payment should be credited to whoever account you are crediting it to, such that whether there's a bank holiday, sir. As you know, sir, if there's a bank holiday, you know what? When you have bank holidays in and it's a Monday, but the payment's still due the Monday, technically, because that's how it's programmed. Now, of course, one would have to go in and do an override to thing because your bank is closed on a Monday, right? The transaction then is credited on a Tuesday. So too much complicated programming, too much intervention, sir, with respect to all of this. And therefore, that is what we are working towards with respect to the national payment system in terms of ensuring that all of the payment service providers have the infrastructure in place to ensure that payments happen in real time. So there's no need to lag, you ain't getting a batch of transactions to go through, and all of that will be a thing of the past, so that it don't matter whether the bank open or not, sir.
In other news this Tuesday, the Treasury is set to receive a $100 million loan from the International Development Bank, which is set to finance policies geared towards sustainable development, water, and sanitation. President of the IDB Group, Mauricio Clavier Claron, made the announcement today during a press conference at the IDB country office as he wrapped up his first official visit to the country.
In the approval of a new $100 million policy-based loan, which will focus on sustainable development, mainly on issues of resiliency, but also water and sanitation, which are obviously key in that regards. So we're expanding, obviously, our partnership with Barbados in that regards. But also, you know, what our team has done here and the visit that we've seen from our team, you know, yesterday, Jessica and our Vice President for Countries, Richard, visited the port. The port is a strategic project for Barbados that can really be a game changer from a commercial perspective. And we're looking into ways how we can work with the government of Barbados, but also with the private sector to crowd in some financing in order to be able to modernize the port, which would be a game changer.
Mauricio Clavier Caron said that Barbados is set for a big rebound in tourism in 2022, especially from the U.S. market. He said the current numbers indicate that visitors from the U.S. outnumbered those from the United Kingdom last year, and the trend is likely to continue.
We're seeing the numbers, we're seeing hotel occupancy move up, we're seeing more tourists come, and we're seeing a higher proportion of American tourists come than before the pandemic. And one of those opportunities, which we had heard during the tourism roundtable we did at our Miami event with the leaders and executives from hotels, cruise lines, airlines, etc., is that they anticipate in the next 3 to 5 years, there's going to be a larger movement and concentration of U.S. tourists to Latin America and the Caribbean, which is a great opportunity for Barbados, then before the pandemic, because travelers are going to be more skeptical to go far, to go to Asia, to go to Europe even, etc. So they're going to be staying nearby, which is a great opportunity for the region. And already you see it in the matrix of travelers that are coming, that are just in the past few months, that have been coming for the first time, I believe, as I was told, U.S. travelers there were larger numbers of U.S. travelers and tourists here to Barbados than U.K. tourists, which is usually more the other way around. So it's a great opportunity there, and we are going to also be working hand in hand with the government of Barbados in order to ensure that we take advantage, full advantage of that opportunity.
47 men and 59 women tested positive for the viral illness. They were identified from the 1,218 tests conducted by the Best Dos Santos Public Health Laboratory on Monday. Of the 106 new cases, 14 persons were under the age of 14 and 92 were 18 years and older. The number of people in isolation facilities numbered 303, while 2,084 were in home isolation. As of December 6, there were 240 deaths from the virus, and under the National Vaccination Program for COVID-19, the total number of persons who are fully vaccinated is 138,416, which is 51.1% of the total population, or 60.6% of the eligible population.
There's regional and international news after this short break.
Hi, my name is Michelle Hines, and I own a company called HM Novelties. I have 3 children, 2 of which are under the age to get the vaccine, and that makes them vulnerable. And the eldest, she is vaccinated, and that's a good thing because all she wants to do is hang with her friends. I take care of my 80-year-old mum, and she has many comorbidities. And I love my mum, and I would not want for anything to happen to her. I am one of the ones that suffered absolutely no symptoms for either the first or the second jab. When you have the vaccine, you have a weapon to fight against this virus, to fight against this beast. 95% of my friends and family are vaccinated, and that literally makes me feel secure.
Let's roll up our sleeves and get back to living.
To regional news now, the St. Vincent and Grenadines Teachers Union is gearing up to take industrial action against the COVID-19 vaccine mandate. The union had previously called on its members, vaccinated and unvaccinated, to attend physical and online school on Monday and to stay away from all face-to-face and online classes on Tuesday and Wednesday. We get the details from SVG TV.
We are expecting that the teachers will come out in the numbers, both unvaccinated and vaccinated. And we want the parents also to join us. The parents and the students. I know some schools now doing exams, but we could put the exams on hold for just those 2 days and do it after. I want everybody to support the teachers in this very important, crucial time. All the taxi drivers, the van drivers, the fisher folk, the farmers, the other trade unions, the rest of civil society. Now is the time to rise up and to stand with the teachers of the nation.
On the international front, Rohingya refugees from Myanmar are suing Meta Platforms, formerly known as Facebook, for $150 billion over claims that the social media company did not take action against the Atar Rohingya hate speech that contributed to the violence. We get more in this report from Reuters TV.
The social media giant is accused of not taking action against hate speech that contributed to violence against the minority group in 2017. In August of that year, more than 730,000 Rohingya fled Myanmar's Rakhine state after a military crackdown. Refugees said the violence included mass killings and rape, while rights groups documented killings of civilians and burning of villages. Myanmar authorities say they were battling an insurgency and deny carrying out systematic atrocities. A US class action complaint filed in California on Monday argued that Facebook had failed to police anti-Rohingya hate speech. Lawyers said that failure and the design of the platform contributed to real-world violence against a Muslim group.
That's news, but for the very latest, you can visit us at www.barbadostoday.bb. You can also subscribe to our e-paper, email updates, or like us on Facebook, and sign up for our breaking news alerts via WhatsApp. We're also on iZumi Media and bus terminals, as well as Screenplay at supermarkets and gas stations near you. You can also hear us on Capital Media HD 99.3 FM.